Hey folks, welcome to Lyrics to Go. I'm Daniel, and I'm really glad you're with me today. I have a special guest. I got to speak to a musical theater friend and colleague of mine named Pete Mills. Now, Pete is someone whose work I have long respected and admired and enjoyed. He is the writer of a whole bunch of musicals. He wrote music and lyrics for Illyria, The Flood, Golden Boy of the Blue Ridge, and most recently, The Hello Girls. He was also the lyricist on the musical theater adaptation of The Honeymooners, the classic sitcom. Pete's a very detail-oriented writer, a real consummate craftsman, which I always appreciate encountering in another writer. And we had a real wide-ranging discussion about a whole bunch of things. In part one, which you're about to watch, we speak mainly about a song from Beauty and the Beast with lyrics by Howard Ashman, someone we both revere. In the upcoming parts of this interview, you'll hear us speaking about a song by Stephen Sondheim. You'll hear us talking about Pete's own work and sort of his own approach to his lyrics. There's also going to be a bonus episode that's just for my Patreon subscribers, where we talk about a whole bunch of different things, including the challenge of writing opening numbers for musicals. And Pete breaks down a song he loves from The Music Man and a bunch of other stuff. So you're not going to want to miss that, especially if you're a musical theater fan, and even if you're not. So to become a Patreon subscriber and get full access to that episode and every other piece of content I put out, plus other perks like custom playlists, merch, and all kinds of other swag, head on over to patreon.com/lyrics2go and sign up at the $5 level a month or higher. So that's it for me. Now please enjoy my interview with Pete Mills. Oh, and like and share and subscribe and all that good stuff.
Lyrics to Go.
Hey.
Well, hey Pete, welcome to Lyrics to Go. It's great to see you.
Thanks. I'm honored to be here, and I'm glad we made this work out after some delay.
Hey, absolutely. And you know what? In terms of COVID time, the way the theater world is happening right now, nothing's happening before 3 years from now. So that it happened in this quarter, never mind this year, is a miracle.
So much stuff in the pipeline now, though.
Exactly. It's pipeline upon pipeline upon pipeline. Pete's won all the awards that I've won, plus a couple more. So I shake my fist in congratulation at him. and we've also worked together. Pete hired me, you hired me at a musical theater, like summer day camp for kids.
Prospect Camp, yes, the summer teen intensive.
What was that, 2014?
Oh gosh, yeah, it's like, I'll need my notes. Wait, can we check that after? Let's say 2014, it was a while back.
It was a while back, yeah. So anyway, welcome Peter Mills. To Lyrics to Go.
I'm so excited to be here.
Yeah, thank you. Now, I have one beef with your bio. There's one glaring omission. Les Misérabbits isn't in there. It was your brilliant merger of Les Mis and Watership Down.
Yeah, Les Misérabbits, even though it was from 2014 or whatever year we agree that was, that you did our camp, It recently had a glorious new incarnation as a web musical project where have you not seen? Oh my gosh.
I have not seen, no.
Go search on YouTube now for the new YouTube version of Les Misérabbits. It's pretty epic. We with kids from all over the country, no, all over the world really, because we had some folks from England doing it, all self-taping in their homes, sending out tracks to everybody and everybody sending them back to me, giant editing project. We made Les Misérabbits the movie. So
that's unbelievable.
During the pandemic.
That I can't wait to see it. And I will of course be splicing it in to this interview right here.
When you pick up a book and you look at the title, and the title you see there is Watership Down. Well, a typical person would think there's a ship and the ship's gonna sink, and there might be torpedoes and maybe some people will drown. With a title like Watership Down, that's what you hope. But no, it's a book about rabbits.
Seriously?
It's a book about rabbits.
So Pete, I'm here to have you on to talk about lyrics from a number of different angles. And It's funny. You're my first musical theater colleague. You're my first musical theater writer guest on the show. And this will be really my first episode looking at musical theater in depth. I did do one episode where I sort of dove all the way into Feed Me Seymour.
I saw that you've done specific songs. Is that the only musical theater song that you've done?
That's the only musical theater song that I've looked at in any depth, yeah.
Wow. Well, Ashman is, as you know, is sort of on my list. So I fully approve the in-depth study.
Yeah. Well, so what do you love about Ashman?
I love how he's able to be so whimsical, and it feels almost like off the cuff, spur of the moment, just delightful ideas. And yet it's so controlled and still totally in the form or whatever, but there's mm-hmm. this incredible spontaneity in his lyrics that feel tossed off in the best possible way.
You know? Absolutely. Yeah. And it's, and there's almost, he's almost winking at you, but he's not interrupting the flow of things to wink at you. Like the wink just kind of goes by. It's not super ironic. Like there's a pleasant level of irony, which if you're listening for it, like in Little Shop, there's all kinds of lines that you can enjoy extra if you get the cultural references or whatever, or if you get the sort of, I don't know, the comedic thrust of a particular line.
With his Disney things, he was doing that all the time because it worked on all those levels where it's like, yes, the kids are gonna like this and there's nothing inappropriate for the kids, but there's more there for the adults to kind of appreciate.
Yeah. I'm on the job, you big nabob. I mean, what kid is gonna be like, oh, what a delightful turn of phrase.
For but putting nabob in a lyric. Yes, I love him. So.
Exactly. Yeah, no, Ashman is, he's truly amazing. And I wish we'd gotten to hear more from him. You really hear how special he was, and not to diss Tim Rice or anything, but like on that Aladdin soundtrack, which is, you know, in the middle of which Tim Rice took over because Howard Ashman passed away. You all of a sudden have a score that's kind of bifurcated. You got the Ashman side and the Rice side, and on the Rice side, you got a whole new world. And on the Ashman side, you've got Friend Like Me, you got, what are the other songs he does?
Well, who did Prince Ali? I hope that was, I was
Ashman. It's obviously Ashman, yeah.
I love Prince Ali, and I was like, oh no.
That's one of my favorite musical theater songs, for sure.
Make way, here he comes, ring bells, bang the drum. Are you gonna love this guy? Prince Ali, fabulous he, Ali Ababa. Genuflect, show some respect. Down on one knee.
Genuflect, show some respect down on one knee. That's brilliant.
Brush up your Sunday salam.
Yeah, brush up your Sunday salam. Well, that's probably culturally inappropriate, actually, but...
It is, but it was far from the most culturally inappropriate song in that show at the time. It was overshadowed by, what was that line that they had to cut out?
Oh, I come from a land, from a faraway place, where the caravan camels roam. Where they cut off your ear if they don't like your face. It's barbaric, but hey, it's home.
It's barbaric, but hey, it's home.
Yeah.
I know all the things of my youth, my formative years, we're now taking a second look at now. But nevertheless,
Ashman was always such a craftsman. So actually, I asked you in preparation for this show, and we're going to talk about some of your stuff. But I thought maybe, since we're on the topic of Ashman, why don't we start with three musical theater lyrics that just tickle you and that you consider like, you know, sure, paragons of the form. Like just, this is musical theater lyric writing at its best. So one of the songs you mentioned is from an Ashman musical, Beauty and the Beast, and it's the opening song, Belle, right? So what is it about Belle as an opener that grabs you
big
so much?
Picture, and this is one of the songs that I often talk about when I'm teaching. I've done some lyric writing tutorials at NYU at our program that we went to.
Oh, excellent. I'm getting free. This is free tuition right here.
Yeah. I think it's remarkable in how much it accomplishes in such a relatively compact amount of time, because I feel like it is maybe comes in under 5 minutes still somehow. I could be wrong,
it's about that. Yeah.
And yet it does like all of the things that you might possibly expect an opener to do in terms of establishing the time and place, the milieu, introducing your main character, setting up kind of the initial conflict with the Gaston and like the kind of the first plot point really we get mm-hmm. to with his proposal of marriage. It gives us her voice. It gives us what the town is thinking of her. It gives us, you know, charming local color and Provence and all the flavor of that. Does so much so quickly. It has like, it has the soaring C-section or whatever that it stole from the other song, the oh, isn't this amazing?
Oh, isn't this amazing? It's my favorite part because you'll see. That it's him till chapter three.
But she doesn't know it's him till chapter three.
Lovely bit of like foreshadowing and preparation for her own storyline.
Yeah.
It's so good. It weaves in and out of the little scene vignettes that are there. It does it so easily and so naturally. Yeah. It's one of the things where I'm very, like early on in my writing, I used to write songs with a lot of embedded dialogue and, you know, going in and out of scene to song a lot because I thought that was very sophisticated and slick. Now it's like, I hate it when it's just because I don't know, I think more in terms of like the cast album and when I'm listening to a track, it's like, I don't want to listen to scenes. I just want like an awesome song. And
well, it's not just the cast album. You're right. The cast album heightens the contradictions to an intolerable degree where the scenes have to get cut down a lot. But I mean, I didn't want this to be true. When they taught me this at NYU, mm-hmm. There's so many things about musical theater conventions that I've wanted to reject out of hand because they were inconvenient or because I like disagreed, like I had an opinion about it. Unlike you, I think I didn't grow up listening to a lot of musical theater. So I've come at it kind of remedially. So I've had to learn which rules are ironclad or semi-ironclad and which ones are just kind of aesthetic conventions. But one of them is that once the music starts, you're in a different gear. And now spoken dialogue is of a lower currency. Like it just takes a lot.
Yeah.
But it actually, or maybe it's of a higher currency in that it takes a lot less of it. Like we can only take, it's rich. What's the right metaphor? It's that you're primed. Do you want to hear people singing basically?
It has to be almost as condensed as we expect lyrics themselves to be.
And lyrics are very condensed, yes.
Like, make your point and move on. Like, we can't tolerate naturalistic dialogue. We're like, hey, how's it going? Oh, no.
It's like, I know. I found this with the trouble. Going. Yeah.
The underscoring is going. Keep it moving. Anyway. Yeah. Getting back to Belle, I think it does it very well in that, you know, what little scene vignettes it gives us are important and do a lot as well.
Yeah.
And allow a musical vocabulary that's gonna do embedded, threaded scene to song. And yet I can still listen to it just as a musical experience and not get tired of the fact like, oh, they're talking and they have another like, you know, 30 seconds of dialogue before they sing again, you know?
Well, a lot of the things that would be dialogue, like the shopkeepers, you know,
I need to you know,
egg, you know, yeah, right. You know, the fish, the cheese, whatever, like it's all built. It's very economical in that there, you talked about the C-section. There really are only like really three kind of musical statements. Maybe there's that, there's the verse intro, right? The little town, it's a quiet village, blah, 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 that stands on its own. But then we get into it. It's the da 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 da.
There goes the baker with his tray like always. The same old bread and rolls to sell. Every morning just the same. Since the morning that we came to this poor provincial town.
Good morning, pal.
Morning, monsieur.
And then there's da 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 da.
Bonjour.
Good day.
How is your family?
Bonjour.
Good day.
How is your wife?
And like, that's really all they have to play with. And like, then that more lyrical thing that you talked about.
Yeah, I used to think of the song, I was like, oh, it's like a chorus. The chorus of the song is Bonjour, you know, because that felt very refrain-like. But then at some point I realized, no, the title of the song is Belle. Belle is there at the end of every, charming girl, that Belle. It's an AABA song.
That's right.
That has
and
a
the beat. Yeah, and the Bonjour part isn't, you know, musically it's not settled anywhere. It's kind of a departure from
that's true.
The home key, you know.
It does that bridge thing where it has two different key centers. No, you're in a bridge.
So now we're talking about Mencken.
Yes, that's true. Sorry, I'll get off. No music talk here. We're here strictly to talk about lyrics. Yes. But anyway, I think it's so incredibly well-crafted and economical. And when I said in my email to you, when I said, okay, maybe it's not perfect, like there are a couple little things that I pick on it even in class where I talk about like how, you know, notice how Mencken had to adjust the melody here to fix the scan is like with a dreamy far off look and her nose stuck in a book.
I heard that there. Yeah.
You're the part of any crowd.
Cause her head's up on some cloud.
With a dreamy far off look.
And her nose stuck in a book.
Cause you couldn't say, and her nose stuck in a book.
Right. Cause I was like, well, in a perfect world, once you've set the musical form, you should, you know, your lyrics going to fit that every time or whatever. But in that case, Mencken is like, okay, I'll fix it for you. You know, so it doesn't sound like no stuck in a, you know, it's slightly misaccented. It's slightly hard to understand. So they change it. What was the other thing? Oh, it does the life wife rhyme twice, which is already supposed to, apparently the most common rhyme in musical theater, life and wife, where she does the, well, it happens at the end with there must
Gaston.
Be more provincial life. Just watch, I'm going to make Belle my wife. But it does it earlier in the song too. And that's like, I don't think there's a rule about this, but I always look over my lyric to see if I've like used the same rhyme.
I don't like to use the same rhyme twice in a show if I can avoid it.
That's a higher standard than I.
If I can avoid it, if I can avoid it. Or at least I want to use the words, I want to flip the meanings of the words. That's just a persnickety thing. It's not a, I wouldn't hold anyone else to that.
That is tough.
just a way of making my life harder. You said that, you mentioned how, you know, he introduces the main conflict, right? With Gaston coming in. Mm-hmm. I think what's interesting is that even before Gaston comes in, I was just listening to
it. He introduces his character with LeFou and
Not only that, there's a more fundamental general conflict that pre-exists Gaston, which is internal conflict to her, which she doesn't fit in.
It's a pity and a sin, she doesn't quite fit in.
And we've already gotten that. And a sense of, and when you meet your main character and they're in their environment and they don't belong. Like, you know, when we meet Usnavi in the Heights, the conflict is not, when is this guy going to get out of this hellhole that he hates? That's not what the opening song sets up. He loves it. He's going to stay and something's going to happen inside of it. Same thing with Tevye. He's not itching to get out of Manatevka, even though that's how it ends. But with Belle, she's not necessarily like, fuck y'all, I'm out of here. But she is saying there must be more than this provincial life. She's sighing. She's dreaming. Everyone's looking at her. They're at odds with her. So the song sets up these multiple layers of tension into which this, you know, this unstoppable force called Gaston comes in.
Yeah. And I'd forgotten exactly, there's more Gaston, now I'm remembering, than I thought, because it reuses the same form where the girls of town talk about him. Look, there he goes. They talk about him the same way they just talked about Belle. Then he uses the forms for his, in town there's only she who is beautiful as me.
Here in town there's only she who is beautiful as me. So I'm making plans to woo and marry Belle.
Look there, he goes, isn't he dreaming?
Belle is so in her own world in the song that it's really, she's in some ways just the object of everyone's, projections, desires, opinions, all this kind of stuff. And so another tension that bubbles up for me as I'm listening to it is, when is she going to take an action that's more than just taking a book out from the bookstore?
True.
You know, and what's going to happen when she makes a choice? Like what are the consequences going to be? You know, I had never seen Beauty and the Beast. I didn't know the score until
the movie. Even
I don't think I'd ever seen the movie. No. I saw Aladdin in the theaters back then, but I never saw The Little Mermaid. I never saw Beauty and the Beast. And I just didn't think much of it. Like, this is my trajectory with a lot of musicals, like just insouciant arrogance and ignorance. And then I discovered, I'm like, holy shit, has anyone ever heard of this? This is great. But then a friend of mine in Vancouver, when I was living there a few years ago, asked me to come and coach her musical theater high school students. She ran the drama program there. And they were doing you know, the high school version. And she asked me to come do like lyric interpretation coaching, like acting coaching. And I found myself, first of all, just enjoying every lyric so much. But then when we got to the opening song, you know, the theme song, Beauty and the Beast, I was weeping as I was talking to these kids about what it meant. I'm like, but like they already knew. And I was discovering, I'm like, don't you see? Finding, you know, beautiful and strange, finding you can change, learning you were wrong. Don't you see? It's about all of us. It's about discovering that our ideas about ourselves are not set in stone. You know, like, and I actually had tears coming down my cheeks.
That's the type of song, I don't know this, but it seems to me like that was probably a music first type of song. Mm-hmm. Because it's
I have to think so.
And beautiful melody. And then this is the hardest type of thing for me of all, of any like lyric writing type task, but like a melody like that, that is so succinct where every phrase is like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like to say something and you can't have like any word that pulls the ear too much or like takes you out of this like ballad moment, and yet it has to be like kind of original and fresh and say something meaningful. And
you can't insist on perfect like syntax either. You have to be willing to just be poetic. Tale as old as time, true as it may be. Like that's fine, because we're in the world of it's larger than life. It's thematic, you know. What I'm saying is that as a lyricist, you have to be willing to be a bit more abstract, I think.
Just a little change, small to say the least, both a little scared, neither one prepared, Beauty and the Beast.
I feel like with ballads so much, you have to just go back to like, on a gut level, like your ear and like what sounds right.
And what like feels
you
right.
You can't be as much in your head about like logic and like developing an argument or something or whatever. Like you're just putting the right syllables on this beautiful melody. Yes, they have to be like, you know, on message, so to speak.
Well, they have to say like, something, yeah.
The task is like almost like to do no harm, almost.
That's all for part one. Seems we're out of time, yet there's more from us. Next time we'll discuss something by Sondheim.
Fiver, is something wrong, dear brother? You tremble so. Oh, Hazel, I have seen a sign. A sign, you say? What did you see? Was this an omen from your rabbit ESP?
No, I literally saw a sign.
Oh,
but it was written in English, and I only know Lapine.
My fellow rabbits, our life here has been a good one. But soon the men will come and put a stop to it. And if we're to find a new safe haven, then we must hop to it.
Welcome, my friends, you're safe with us now. Share in our burrow, unfurrow your brow.
Days here are lazy, grass here is sweet. Portions are venti, there's plenty to eat.
You'll never find a refuge so kind and auspicious. And I have to say, who knew life could be so good?
Oh, it's simply delicious.
I have a bad feeling about this place, guys.
Here you know that word for female, dear, for female.